We're continuing our series, Acts, the Apostles' Movement. And so this morning, I have a lengthier passage, so I'm going to ask you to remain seated as we read Scripture together. But here's the word of the Lord this morning for the people of God. And it says, "And Saul approved of the killing of him." We're in chapter 8 of Acts. "On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered through Judea and Samaria, and godly men buried Stephen, mourned deeply for him. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison." Now let's skip to chapter 9. "Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, 'Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?' 'Who are you, Lord?' Saul asked. 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting,' he replied. 'Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do.' The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. And for 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus there was a disciple named Ananias. And the Lord called to Ananias in a vision and said, 'Ananias.' 'Yes, Lord,' he answered. The Lord told him, 'Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. And in a vision he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight.' 'Lord,' Ananias answered, 'I've heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name.' But the Lord said to Ananias, 'Go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name.' Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, 'Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me to you so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit.' Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength." The word of the Lord for the people of God, and we all say together, thanks be to God. Have you ever thought about people who have come dramatically to faith in Christ? You have these moments where throughout the history we have these dramatic stories of someone being saved out of the depths of sin and depravity, all the brokenness of life, and they have a fantastic resurrection story of their life, of how they were saved and how they turned their life around for Jesus. And here's the funny thing. We highlight this particular story in Acts, and do you know that it's one of three successive stories of conversion in Acts? And we celebrate the one of Paul or Saul on the Damascus Road because it's the most dramatic, it's the most powerful story. But do you know not everybody's conversion story is like that? Did you know that's okay? Do you know what's most important? It's not about your resurrection story or your conversion story of how glorious and magnificent it was. It's how well do you follow the one who saved you after. That's good preaching. It doesn't have anything to do with how massively life turned around. Thanks be to God for those incredible resurrection stories. But we come to this place in Acts and we go, oh, Saul's conversion, that's the way that it has to be. Everybody needs a Damascus Road experience. No, we don't. You see, God spoke in the middle of the road to Damascus for Saul because that's what Saul needed. God doesn't stop everybody in the middle of the road and say, hey, here's the sky writing, here's the big light, here's the voice from heaven. Not everybody's story is like that. The important part is whether what you do with it after you have been converted by Jesus Christ and what he does and he calls you to do and how he empowers you to live from then on out. Because if we have, everybody has the same conversion experience, what's so good about that? Everybody's story is different. Look to your neighbor and tell them, you have a story. Online, put in the comments, you have a story. Everybody's conversion story is different, and it's all because we are individuals, and we are different, and we are all made in the image of Christ, and he wants to save everyone, but not everyone comes to Christ the same way. That's okay. That's good news for us, because we don't have to have this moment. We pick this moment in time in our series because there are three roles that are played in this story. And so we have Saul, who has been the murderous, threatening antagonist of the story of the people of the way. Now, the people of the way are the description of the Christians who are gathering at this point in time. They are called the people of the way. That's what they have given their namesake. And so he is out to get anyone who opposes traditional, fundamental Judaism. He is out to destroy anything that would threaten his worldview, his way of life. He has a very nationalistic point of view that he is out for his. He's going to protect Israel. He's going to keep Israel pure. He's going to do all the right things and say all the right stuff. And he's going to put anybody away who is in opposition to that authority of the law. And he is going to make sure that they either go to prison or they die. This is the person that God is going to save. The most recent person I can think of in our current history as a nation would be Osama bin Laden. Someone who is diametrically opposed to a people group who has decided that he is going to rid the world of those folks. Now think about this. How many of you would go, hey, sign me up to forgive that person? Because there's a second person in our story named Ananias. Ananias' name means the grace of Yahweh, the grace of God. Interestingly enough, he's the second Ananias mentioned in our story in Acts, but his story is different from the first one. The first one disobeyed God. This Ananias chooses to obey. But here's the message from the Lord. Ananias, there's a man from Tarsus. His name's Saul. Time out. I know this one. This is the guy who's been coming from Jerusalem to kill and destroy your church, your people, the people that I do life with, because we have proclaimed your name, Jesus, and now you want me to go to this man. How many of you would volunteer for that position? Anybody? The mortal enemy of your faith, the person who is out to get you, who's to grind you into dust. I don't know that many of us would say, sign me up, Lord. But Ananias says, yes, Lord, before he even starts. Did you notice that? Chapter 9, the Lord speaks to Ananias and he says, yes, Lord. It's interesting to me that we have the one who is hating everyone and causing all the disruption in the church, has scattered the people of God. That's why Ananias and his crew are scattered to the ends of the earth in Damascus. They have run from Jerusalem because they have been persecuted, and they have good authority that the church or the temple in Jerusalem has given the authority to Saul to hunt down these folks. And God says, Ananias, I want you to go to Judas's house on Straight Street and see a man from Tarsus named Saul, because I have prepared for him to be the leader of the church. Now, how many of you believe God has a sense of humor? Right? Think about this just for a second. Saul, the most loyal, faithful subject of Judaism, protecting it at all costs, fundamental, just a zealot for his cause, is now going to be the leader and the one who's going to take the church to the ends of the earth and be the one who converts thousands and thousands of people in the missional church of the Gentiles. Tell me God doesn't have a sense of humor. It's like taking a neo-Nazi and putting them in a place with people that they have hated their entire life. Think about this just for a second. This is the equation that we have here. That the only way that this could possibly happen is that God himself reaches into the heart of Saul and transforms him to become something that he can't become on his own. And Ananias is going to step into the place where Saul needs him to be. And he's going to be the one who says, Saul of Tarsus, guess what? God called me to show up and here I am. My name's Ananias. And my name means God's grace. And I'm about to impart it to you. Here's an interesting thought that I had. You know, some of us may have been on this journey for a really long time, and God has called us to be like Ananias, and we have to go to some places that we don't want to go because there's some people like Saul who need to be reached. There's some folks who don't look like us, talk like us, walk like us, live like us, might even be some folks that we may never even think of associating ourselves with, and Jesus is calling us to be the one who steps into the middle of their life and be like Ananias and bring God's grace with us wherever we go. Just saying. So as we unpack this morning, I was reminded of a story of Eustace from C.S. Lewis's The Dawn Treader, The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. And Eustace is a dragon. And Eustace's heart has been hardened. And Eustace is a symbol in the literary work of C.S. Lewis for himself. You see, C.S. Lewis wasn't always the man of faith that everybody quotes and reads Mere Christianity and reads all of those books that he wrote and all the work that he's done and all the ways that God has pursued. No, he was an atheist to begin with. He didn't even believe that God was there. But Eustace was this dragon who had scales and had horns on his back, and it had to come to a place where he comes to the lion Aslan in the book of The Dawn Treader, and he's going to rid himself of his scales, and he starts to peel them off painfully, and he's peeling himself off because his heart is being warmed and he's starting to grow a little bit. But the interesting thing is they keep coming back. The scales keep coming back onto Eustace's body, and he keeps peeling them back, and they keep coming back, and they keep coming back. And Aslan is the only one who is able to remove them. But what happens in the book, I'm going to spoil it for you if you haven't read it, sorry. Go pick it up, and it's a fantastic read, the whole series of Chronicles of Narnia. But Aslan is the God figure in this book, and Aslan cuts him so deep that he peels back all the way to the lowest layer of Eustace's skin, and he reveals the truth of who Eustace really is, and he bears him clean and removes all the scales. And Eustace describes the painful process of all that being peeled back. Saul, on the road to Damascus, is going to destroy the church at all costs. And God arrests him on his way and shows up and speaks life into his spirit and says, Saul, Saul, he calls him out twice. Why do you persecute me? He says, Lord, he's asking a question. He doesn't even recognize that it's Jesus. And Jesus declares what Saul has been doing is he's been doing it to the church. But Jesus said, Saul, why do you persecute me? You see, this is a big old family, right? Jesus, the head of the family, says, you've been persecuting my family. You've been persecuting me. What you do to me, what you've done to them, you've done also to me, right? Jesus even explained that in Luke's gospel. Whatever you've done to the least of these, you also have done unto me. He is the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through him. So Saul, what you've been doing is you've been persecuting me, not just the people whom you're after, but you've been persecuting the one who's calling you. It's God's prevenient grace that meets him on the road to Damascus, and prevenient grace often leads you to a place where you find yourselves alone and broken, in a place where you find yourself hurting and wounded, and Saul's eyes are blinded and he can't see, and he goes to a house that he doesn't know. He's stripped of everything. And he comes to the place for days where he's alone in thought and prayer, wondering what is going on, this encounter that he's had on the road. And there's a man coming, and he's seen a vision. His name's Ananias, and what does Ananias call him? Brother Saul. Brother Saul. Do you know that one of the most sacred names we can speak into lives of people that we do life with are brother and sister, because we are all children of the same God? We give worth and dignity and value when we look into the hearts of other human beings and we recognize them as brother or sister, even before we begin to know them or speak life into them or have any opportunity to do anything with them, because it's hard to hate someone you love. It's difficult to be fearful in that moment when you approach them as a brother or sister in Christ. So you see, the beginning work on that road is the work that God is doing in Saul. It's in us. God is doing work in you, in me. Some of you might be in this room, or some of you online might have heard my voice and said, I've never had that experience. I've never had a conversion moment. I've never said yes to Jesus. Okay, there's a moment where that prevenient grace that's been pursuing you and coming after you calls you and says to you, I want to know you more. I want to have a deep relationship with you. It's the voice of God. It's the prevenient grace, the grace that goes before us. We believe this as a Wesleyan family of faith. We believe that God is pursuing us, going after us. So this whole time that Saul has been murderous, the whole time that Saul has been persecuting the church, Jesus was still pursuing Saul. He was doing a work in his heart. Remember what I said last week about Stephen, as he's holding the coats and standing there watching him stone Stephen? There's something of the blood of the martyrs. Do you realize that the word witness in the scripture is the same word as martyr? The same very word that is used for witness is the same word as used for martyr. What would it mean for us to be people who would give up our lives and testify in the martyr's name of Jesus Christ, that we would serve his purpose and we would be people who would speak truth into the world as witnesses for faith? So Saul, on the road, has a moment where God does a work in him. But you know there's a second work that happens with Ananias. And Ananias does something only through the power of the Holy Spirit. God does something through him. Bobby Rader, can I borrow you for a second? He's a good doctor. Hopefully this will work. Ananias comes in and declares, Brother Saul, I have been brought here by the Holy Spirit. And he touches his eyes, and scales come off of his eyes. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't go around touching people's faces. Bobby, how messed up is touching somebody's face?
Couldn't be messed up.
Couldn't be messed up, right? All the germs on our hands, we don't go around greeting each other with, like, hey, let me put my hand on your face, right? But there's something of brotherhood, of intimacy, of friendship, of loyalty, that someone would come in and touch somebody on the face. I'm not going to touch your face, but I do love you. But here's the thing. Ananias had protest. He had fear, but he went to his brother Saul and went with him. Now I need you to stay here just for a second. Okay. Later in chapter 9, there's another person. BJ, I need you to join me up here. A man named Barnabas. And Barnabas, we found in chapter 4, he is the son of encouragement. Be encouraging. All right. So the son of encouragement was in chapter 4. He had donated his land, and that was the first time we had met him. But on the way of life, Barnabas becomes a traveler, a minister of the gospel, and Ananias... I will be Ananias. He's Saul. This is Barnabas. Ananias does a work that the Lord gives him and helps him and encourages Saul and teaches Saul. But that's the end of Ananias' story. We never hear from Ananias again. But somewhere along the way, Saul is introduced to a man named Barnabas. And they become friends. And they do life together. And Barnabas, the son of encouragement, begins to teach the one who nobody wants to be a friend of. Can you imagine that? He's tried to kill it. I know he doesn't look this way, but he's tried to kill the church. You don't look like that, but all right. But Barnabas is convinced that God's grace is bigger, that God's grace is greater, that there is something that God was doing in the heart of Saul through the servant Ananias and between the two of them, that God was at work proving who he is, who he was, and who he will be. And Saul is going to become Paul, the greatest missionary in the life of the church, because someone named Barnabas believed in the conversion story of Saul. We get the conversion story how? Because Luke was the one who reported it. Where did he report it from? Saul and Barnabas. He was a friend of theirs. He heard the story firsthand. And there's something that happens in the life of Barnabas that says, I'm going to take you on and bless you and encourage you and help you and give you the wisdom that you need and teach you. And what does Saul do? Saul goes with him. Saul and Barnabas work together. Now here's the thing. The rest of the disciples, the apostles in Jerusalem, they decide to take a trip back to Jerusalem. And Barnabas leads the way and takes them there and takes Saul with him. And he goes to the disciples and says, you've got to meet this guy. He's different. He's changed. And all of Jerusalem rejects him. They don't believe it. And what does Barnabas do? Barnabas takes Saul by the hand. Check this out. I know it seems kind of weird, but it's not. This symbol is a symbol of covenant. Because when they would make covenant together in this culture, they would cut their wrists and put the blood together, and symbolizing the hands coming to the wrists coming together. This is a symbol of covenant that Barnabas makes, and he takes Saul from apostle to apostle and proving to them who Saul is, that he's changed, he's different, he vouches for him. You guys can be seated. Thank you. You got to follow him. Yeah, there you go. Go together. Thank you, gentlemen. You see, something happens in us in conversion. And along the road, something deeper happens through us when we say, yes, Lord. And we respond to the things of God and what he's calling us toward and what he's calling us to become. And there's moments where we're like Ananias and we say, oh, Lord, do you really want me to go there? Because do you know the story? And he goes, I don't. I'm surprised. He knows the story. He's not shocked. He's not put off. But what better way to reach the peoples of the earth than to convert its greatest enemy? Saul was hated, distrusted. He was a murderer. He was out to get the church. Why would anybody believe that this person could possibly be transformed? Because Barnabas had done the work of discipleship. Talks about years of doing life together, Barnabas and Saul, who would become Paul. You see, sometimes we do conversion fairly well, but we miss the parts of being the people who God calls to be, people who are doing work through us and the people who are doing work between us. We often say, hey, great, you got saved. Woohoo, good for the kingdom. Good luck. That's not how the kingdom of heaven worked. That's not how the body of Christ functioned. We see it in Acts time and time again, person after person. The story of Paul throughout the entire New Testament, who writes the majority of the New Testament, has a person who is always with him on the journey. There's always someone in the letters that he's mentioning, that he's discipling, he's pouring into. Why? Because he learned it from the son of encouragement who thought together, it's between us. It's not just with us. There's something that happens deeply in the movement of God for the people of God, that we become a people who are converted and God does his work in us, then he begins to do his work through us, and there's the deeper work of God doing work between us. Because we become his hands. We become his feet. We become his missionaries who are sent to the ends of the earth. And all of a sudden, Saul becomes the greatest apostle ever, not because of something that he did, but because the powerful grace of Jesus cleansed him, purified him, sanctified him, and called him on mission and put him into the practice of the kingdom of God. I still believe God can do it. I believe God can do that today. You see, I just wonder if we're willing to move past the work that has been done in us to the work that's done through us to the work that's going to be between us. Because that's what the church needs to be. The movement of God who identifies someone whom everybody else rejects and will vouch for them and stand up with them and do covenant life with them and say, no, they're changed. They're transformed. They're new. There's something different. I told you about my friend Billy Oswald, who took me to Spanky's Shenanigans Bar for lunch. It's a biker bar. Look at me. I don't look like a biker. I walked in, and there's the family side, ironically. Then there was the biker side. He walks into the biker side. I'm like, of course. Perfect. I walk in, and I am the smallest guy in the room by a lot. Tats and biker chains and all this stuff, right? And we sit up at a table, and I'll never forget it. Billy Oswald, who I'd come to know through his father's funeral and doing life with their family, introduces me to everyone in the biker bar as Pastor Nate, and you need to go to his church up on Highway 7. And he took me from person to person, and I shook their hand, and I got out in the parking lot, and I was like, I'd never been there in the 4 years that I'd lived there. I'd never walked into that bar because I was afraid of what people might say. Didn't even cross my mind. And Jesus, the whole way in the parking lot and on the way home and when I got home to Carrie, God forgive me. Because they need you too. And I was afraid to walk in, and my buddy Billy put his big old arm around me and his cut-off shirt and his do-rag. You'll never meet a better preacher than this. He was the best evangelist I've ever met. I wonder, what might happen, church, if we would be people who go from the work that Jesus has done in us to the ministry that God is doing through us to living it to another level of going to be the people who God will use between us and whoever them are. The them that don't fit your particular worldview or your idea of how life ought to be, because that's the people that God was going to reach through Saul. The nobodies, the down and outs. I distinctly remember a conversation between some disciples and a man who came from Nazareth. And they said, could anything good come from Nazareth? And Jesus, the Nazarene, had come from that hometown. It even harkens back to our own name as the church, because there was a barn in Los Angeles that was started not just for the work that God was doing in us, and it wasn't the work that God was going to do just through us. It was a work that was going to be done between us called the Glory Barn. And a guy named Phineas Brzee started a church called the Nazarene, the Pentecostal Holiness Church of the Nazarene at the time. We became the Church of the Nazarene later. And the work that the Nazarene was going to do was going to reach the down and out, the nobodies, the people that nobody else wanted. I believe that mission is still the same. That the heartbeat of God is for the least, the lost, and the broken and the people who are so full of their religiosity that they can't even see past the myopic nose on their face, and the guy like Saul who needed to be stopped in the road in Damascus, that he was going to have a work done within him, and he was going to meet someone who would do work of God in and through him, and he was going to be blessed by meeting Barnabas who would do life with him and between them. So I wonder, for this congregation and those of us online, would we be willing to be participants in that kingdom and that movement that goes to places and invests in lives that seem utterly lost and utterly hopeless, and be willing to step into the gap and be the hands and feet of Jesus and do work and love and serve and give ourselves away for the sake of the kingdom of God? I pray that our answer is yes. Lord, do in us what you need to do in us so you can do through us what you want to do through us. I'm going to invite the worship band to come. One of my favorite artists is Eric Clapton, guitarist, folk singer. He sang a song called If I Could Change the World. And I was thinking about that song this week. You know, oftentimes we want credit for changing the world. We want to be the one who gets the story told. You know, Barnabas and Paul have a falling out and go their separate ways, and they repair it eventually. But we don't hear a whole lot of stories of Barnabas outside of a few other stories later. You see, I wonder, if I want to change the world, I'm pretty sure that Jesus first has to change me. So I'm going to ask that you would take a moment where you're seated and ask God to speak to your heart. Today it might be that in the hearing of my voice online and on campus that you may have never settled the issue with Jesus as Lord and Savior like Saul had to do with Ananias that afternoon. Or it could be that God has been asking you to be Ananias and your resistance has been, Lord, do you know the rest of this story? I can't do that. Or maybe you've been desiring to change the world and you want to be a part of the movement of God, and yet it's just more convenient, more comfortable, easier to stay in the place where I'm at and doing life the way I've done it, because stepping out of my comfort zone, out and doing the things of God just is, it's hard. And to do the work between us because of discipleship, that's real life. It's messy. It's long hours. It's conversations. There's more to it than just showing up and sitting in a pew. It requires investment. And so there's been some, I'm not ready for work between us. I don't know. But just as Nick plays, just for a moment, ask God, God, is there any work that you want to do in me? Is there any work that you want to do through me? Or Lord, is there any deeper work that you want to do between me and a brother or sister in faith who needs me to be like Barnabas and show up, build covenant, and testify that once they were lost, but by God's grace, now they've been found. Once they were blind, but just like Paul, now they see. I invite you to respond as the Lord leads you this morning.